Hello, and welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the podcast where we talk about screenwriting, filmmaking, and breaking into the industry. I'm your host, Phil Galasso. Today, we have a special episode recorded at the 2019 Austin Film Festival in Austin, Texas. For those of you who don't know, the Austin Film Festival furthers the art and craft of film by inspiring and championing the work of all artists who use the language of film and television to tell a story, with a special focus on writers and writing. You can go there to learn about screenwriting from some of the best in the business, as well as to be inspired by fellow writers, all battling it out each day to create quality work. Our first interview is with Deborah Kaplan and Harry Elfont, creators of the show Liza On Demand, which recently started its second season on YouTube. You may also know Deborah and Harry from their films Can't Hardly Wait and Josie and the Pussycats, which we discussed. Check it out.
Deborah and Harry, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having us.
So you're here to talk. What panel are you guys here for the festival on?
It's just a Q&A with us.
Oh, okay. Really? We're not talking about something?
Well, I don't know. They kind of, we did not know. I looked at the program to find out what we were going to be talking about. I think it's, they mentioned like, you know, kind of going from kind of traditional features to now the digital space because we've got a show on YouTube.
Liza On Demand. Yeah. So talk about that show. It's only just the second season just premiered, right?
It did.
Yes. What do you want to know?
Everything. What was the genesis of it? What's the, you know, differences as you're going to talk on the panel, writing traditional versus the new media?
Well, it's really, I mean, the only difference really is in how they roll it out. It's really just a typical half hour single camera show. The time is a little flexible. Like, we don't have to come in at 20 minutes, 30 seconds. Like, they can be anywhere from 20 to 25 minutes. They're pretty loose about that stuff. And this year we're AVOD, so they've put in, you know, we just put in breaks for commercials. But it's really just the same as writing any other traditional network show, only for way less money.
All right. And talk about the show. Talk about the show itself. Talk about the characters.
I mean, the show was fun because we built it around Liza, Koji, who we were aware of more through our kids than anything else because she was, you know, kind of already an established YouTuber. And they said, somebody came to us and said they want to build a show around her, that it's 8 episodes straight to series. And we had just done a small series for MTV. It was the first time we had done television and thought the idea of going straight into production on something was very appealing, as opposed to being stuck in network development, just kind of writing a script and getting really attached to it and spending a lot of work on it, and then it doesn't get made.
Yeah.
So we thought, well, straight to series sounds good. And then we met Liza and thought, like, oh, she's actually the real deal. She's
awesome.
Genuinely funny, and she seems like we could really build a show around her. So then we kind of, you know, started thinking about what the ideas were. And we thought, like, let's kind of do a modern I Love Lucy.
Yeah.
Let's just kind of just find a premise that we can stick her in as many kind of jams.
She does have an energy like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's very cool.
So that's what we did. And and now we're in our second season. People seem to be watching. I mean, we've got incredible, it was absurd the amount of views. I did not know what we were going to expect.
You can actually see, like, exact number probably.
Only on the first episode of the season. And then they hide them. So we don't know.
Interesting.
You only know if you get picked up for a third season if the rest of the views were
good.
I mean, I don't think they're ever going to hit the number. That first episode, is it like 80-something now?
Close to 80 million.
Yeah. I don't think the rest of them are good. I mean, it's just not possible, right?
Yeah.
And when we had the idea
of 80 million, I don't think any media gets that anymore.
Right?
No, it's crazy. And we did go a little clickbaity because we called the episode Naked, and this first episode of the second season, she's running around town with no clothes. But we had no idea it was going to get that many clicks.
Got to grab those eyeballs.
Yeah.
So you mentioned that this is the second show you've created. You mostly know for features. So what has that transition been like? Or what do you find the differences to be in writing for feature versus television?
I feel like it's a lot more fun.
Yeah.
I mean, aside from the fact that, like, we can't get replaced because it's our show. It's just fun. It's fun to sit in a group of funny people because I think you become funnier by default just sitting in there joking around all day. Your mind just gets sharper. It's a different kind of exercise. And it's also fun to be able to take your time with characters. And in a feature, if you get everything out in, you know, between, well, we never write 90 pages, we write long. But, like, to get everything out, an hour and a half. Whereas this, we have, you know, 10 episodes per season to build a long, slow arc you know, develop the characters.
And so are you guys writing the whole season and then going into production? Or is it like television where you're, you know, kind of writing and producing as you go?
Because we directed the first 5 this season, we wanted to be able to be present for prep.
Okay.
And we didn't actually have the money to keep a room open while we were shooting. So we got all of our scripts done before we started production. I mean, just barely. Like, it was a little hectic. But then they ordered two extra episodes while we were shooting, that really threw us.
did that mess with like your plans for the season as a whole? Like you had, you told a certain story.
Well, we don't really do a serialized story. I mean, it'd be fun to try that another time, but we just every episode's kind of standalone. And we did for the last two, knowing it was going to be two, and we were in the middle of the season. We were like, let's just do kind of one and split it in half. So we did kind of a two-parter. Okay. Well, at one point they talked about it being a special, a holiday special.
That did come up and we were like, what holiday? We thought, well, no show ever does New Year's Eve. People do Christmas, they do Thanksgiving. We're like, let's do New Year's Eve.
Yeah, that's true.
And we sort of went back to those can't hardly wait days of like, it's all one night.
Yeah.
You know, and it's where they start and where they end.
That's very cool. Talk about the writer's room itself. What do you guys like about working in a room? What do you look for in when you're staffing a room?
We try to look for people who have original ideas. Then we'd much rather read an original spec that's out of the box than like, oh, here's my episode of Modern Family that I wrote, on spec. Like, because anyone can sort of latch onto characters they've seen week after week. Mm-hmm. And because they sort of play out the same storylines and tropes every week, it's not that hard to do. We always tend to look for people who write something that's unusual. Because this show is a little unusual. And Mary and Jane was a little unusual.
And as far as you, before you guys did this, you were never staffed on a television show or anything like that. Had you even written any television or was it all brand new to you?
We'd written a couple pilots that got shot and didn't get picked up, but that was it.
Yeah.
We've watched a ton of television. We were both like kids of the 70s who were raised by television.
Yeah. So what shows do you think inform your sensibilities looking back?
And we were total Brady Bunch fans. And that was the first movie.
That must have been
wrote.
A blast getting to write the movie.
That was a dream, It was absurd.
I feel like we peaked then. Like, I'm surprised there's been anything after that. Like, it should have just stopped there. And they're like, well, they're done.
So how did that gig come along? Were they just looking for giant Brady Bunch fans?
I mean, kind of. It was the first script we ever sold. We sold to the Ladd Company, which was producing the first Brady Bunch movie right at the same time. Mm-hmm. So we found out they were shooting that movie and they had the entire house rebuilt for the first time on a set over at Paramount. And they said, do you want to come visit the set? And we made such fools of ourselves taking photographs in every room of the set that that when the movie was a hit and they needed writers for the sequel, and we'd been working with them on that script then kind of developing it, they asked us, they said, would you guys want to write the sequel? And we said yes before they were done asking.
I mean, we had to pitch ideas, but I mean, there were no one better as an authority. That was it.
Yeah.
That was our whole childhood.
And the cast and then those remakes were fantastic.
They nailed it.
And the tone you got, I mean, obviously you just didn't write the first one, but the tone was I feel like it was really ahead of its time as far as like we're in this reboot culture now and there's all this different stuff. Like the way you guys handled those movies was really impressive. What did you feel like you needed to do writing a sequel to something that was already sort of, had a certain tone that you needed to kind of marry to?
Well, it was interesting. Like the first movie was about, how does this family still exist today? Mm-hmm. Like it was that family of the 70s mm-hmm. existing in what year was it?
Like 90, early 94.
Like in the 90s. But we, of course, we were such fans of the show. We wanted to do something that was like almost an extension of the show itself. Mm-hmm. So we were like, what if?
Mm-hmm. Well, it was really asking the question, okay, they've established, again, the first one's the fun of like, okay, here's a family that's out of, out of place in this world. We thought like, what's the greatest threat to this family? It's like, oh my God, Carol's first husband shows up. Like, because they never said like what happened to him. She was just single. They never said if she was a widow. It was actually, the Schwartzes considered that a big deal that they never like, she could have been divorced.
Yeah,
she could have been the forced divorce, but they didn't say.
Yeah.
So we were like, if that guy shows up, that's it. It's the family. And then we started, then the idea that like, and then Greg and Marcia realized they're not related anymore. Maybe they can, everything kind of spun off from there. So we just wanted to put the family in the biggest crisis because they were always such a tight-knit group. It was like, let's just throw that into disarray and then have them come back together at the end.
That's great. You guys mentioned Can't Hardly Wait. For people of a certain age, myself included, that movie is like a touchstone classic. Talk about where that came from. I mean, for me, that movie felt like what I imagine people a little bit older than me feel about John Hughes movies. Like the characters, to this day, I feel like they kind of live on. You can recognize those archetypes still.
Well, I think, your outlook on a lot of things is formed in high school and sort of the way that, sort of cliques and hierarchies and personalities develop there that you can never really shake. And all of us are sort of just still outrunning like the balloons from high school. So it's always a really rich place to be. But I don't think we set out to just make something that we would have the resources to make. Mm-hmm. You know, it had started when I think Harry had seen a documentary on Roger Corman.
Yeah.
And about how they would, you know, he would make movies out of whatever shit was left over from the movie they were making during the week and then take it and shoot it on the weekend.
Yeah.
So our thought was like, well, what do we have the resources to make? You know, we had just like Robert Rodriguez had just come along and said, well, I had a pit bull and a bus and a Mexican town and a guitar. I made El Mariachi. So we're like, what are our resources? Like, we could probably find a house. And we knew a lot of young actors. And at that time, no one was making teen movies. Like, Scream had been shot, I think, but it hadn't quite come out.
Yeah.
And all those people needed work.
Yeah, we really thought it was going to be, let's just kind of do it ourselves. Uh-huh. And then got lucky in that when we were done the script, Scream came out. So suddenly everybody realized, oh, there's a huge market for because they had Clueless was the only really teen comedy to come up. But that was so specific. It was like, didn't really feel like it was, you know, just that Beverly Hills teen thing. So all of a sudden everybody's looking for teen movies and we had one. It was the timing was great. And it was weird because we did say like, what's something that hasn't been done in a while? We weren't, you know, people sometimes try and chase a market and we didn't. We were like, let's just write something that we know we can do. The idea we talked about was like, remember the party scene and Say Anything. Mm-hmm. That's the whole movie. So we ended up being able to make it at a studio level, which we didn't think. It went from being something we could shoot over a weekend to, you know,
so you
a real
were
big movie.
Dedicated to you wanted to direct it from the start.
That's where it came from. It came from being, you know, we had a lot of early success as screenwriters, and then, you know.
You start to move into, you know, when you're new and you don't know anything, you're just kind of grateful to have the job and like, oh, I get a pass at this script. Great. Oh, they gave it to someone else and they completely changed it. And now my name is still on it, getting the bad reviews. Not so great. And it just started, it comes out of a desire to want to control your material. And I know that there are writers who can say like, okay, well, you know, these are my children. And then at a certain point I can give my children to other parents, but like, we just struggled with that.
One of my favorite things in that movie is the character introductions and the freeze frames and the songs that each character gets. Were those all in the script or?
The freeze frames were in the script.
The songs,
the
I imagine
songs,
probably...
you know, that was another thing that like the benefit of making that movie at a studio and our music supervisor at the time, like there, I don't even think they could put that record out and again, because the rights were so exorbitant, but we were able to get all those songs back then. I mean, it did balloon our budget. I think it was over $1 million.
It was a lot. It added a lot to the budget. I mean, Paradise City alone
cost
a ton of money.
I mean, one in Panama and Van Halen wouldn't give it to us. So
really?
Paradise City,
Well, Paradise City works pretty well.
Yeah.
And then another film you guys made that I feel like people are maybe in the last few years finally starting to come around on is Josie and the Pussycats.
Yeah. They're screening that tonight at Alamo Draft House.
Oh, are they?
We're going to speak after.
Oh,
awesome.
Yeah. Oh, what a great place to see that movie, too.
Yeah, I've never been.
Oh, you're going to have a great time. Talk about that film. How, you know, was that something where apparently where you're like, this is something we like a dream project or?
No. It was, and when we talked a lot about what we were going to do next, because Can't Hardly Wait did pretty well. It didn't kind of, you know, it wasn't a huge smash, but it did well enough that we were kind of thinking, what's our next movie going to be? And as we were kicking around ideas, somebody came to us, said they want at Universal, they want to make a Josie and the Pussycats movie. And we said, that sounds really dumb. No thanks. And then they came around again and told us that. And it was kind of, we met on it and it was pretty clear that they said, you guys, this is wide open. You can really do whatever you want. It wasn't like a source material where we had to be, you know, stick really close to a story or characters. It was like, you can kind of do whatever you want with these characters. And we thought, oh, holy shit, we can make a musical.
Yeah.
And that idea, the idea of making an original musical at a studio was too good to turn down.
Yeah.
So that's where it came from. And then I think we did a first outline that was Josie and the Pussycats in Outer Space, just because that was what I remembered most from the cartoons, Saturday morning cartoons. And then we thought, okay, that's kind of silly. And then we thought, well, if it's a musical, what's it really about? What's going on? And that's when we stuck on the kind of like, well, what's going on in pop music right now?
Yeah.
And it feels very saccharine compared to what we kind of grew up on. And let's just kind of do a satire on what's going on in the music business.
Yeah. I feel like the satire stuff is what threw everybody. Originally.
We didn't know. There's a famous, years later, I found a quote from this legendary theater producer, George Abbott. That his quote is, satire is what closes on a Saturday. I had never heard that, unfortunately. And he was not wrong.
Yeah, I've been seeing the marketing for Jojo Rabbit, and they seem to be, like, they say satire so much to, like, I feel like they want people to know going in, this is a satire, because it...
Well, it's not a movie that's about Hitler's somebody's best friend.
Yeah. They got to really get in front of that, and I feel like that's sort of indicative where the audience kind of, if they're not expecting it, can kind of take the rug out from under them. How did you guys get your start together?
We met at NYU, met in film school.
Okay.
And didn't start writing together until about a year or two after.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Deb, we were doing kind of separate things, and Deb was on a location working as a producer's assistant. I was kind of, I had just moved to LA and was kind of trying to write, and she had an idea. She said, I have an idea. I think we should write together. And it was kind of her, you know, a very, very, '90s romantic comedy. But it was right in the middle of that kind of early '90s to mid '90s spec boom. Mm-hmm. So we wrote the spec, and then we sold it right away, and it was fantastic.
Did not get made.
All right.
You don't need to know.
If you'd prefer not to talk about it, that's fine.
It was a sperm bank romantic comedy.
Oh, it's the '90s.
Yeah. And which was crazy because there were many. The fact that ours stood out was nice. Yeah.
One eventually came out, like, I think, the Vince Vaughn one, right?
Yeah, that was years later.
Yeah, it was like the early 2000s.
Based on a French film, I believe.
Yeah. So what's your...
French have the same lowbrow taste we do.
What's your writing process like as partners? Do you just see... Are you in the same room?
We are in the same room for some of the time. For breaking the story, the characters, really heavy outlining, we are in the same room. And then once we have that map, which is highly detailed, we split stuff up. We don't write from a blank page together. We each take little chunks and then we swap them back and forth. And we tend to not go back and revise until the whole thing is done. Mm-hmm. And then we'll revise. If it's a real mess, we might have to re-break and start that whole process again. If it's in decent enough shape, we might rewrite in the same room. It just depends where we are.
And that comes from the experience, because the first thing we did write together, we were at the keyboard together, staring at a blank page, and it was not fun.
People can do it though, right?
Yeah, we would, you know, kind of quibble over the tiniest little things, and then after you get some experience, you realize, oh, we spent 2 hours on that one little thing, and we cut the whole scene.
Yeah,
you know, and that's why we don't go back. Like, we used to go back. We used to kind of revise. We're like, oh, this doesn't seem right, and then you realize again, like, let's just get to the end of the draft. It's all about forward momentum. Like, get to the end of the draft, get to the next draft, because you realize it really is about the rewriting.
Yeah. And are you morning writers, or do you have to, like, give yourself harsh deadlines?
I wish I could do, when we first were writing, I would like to write at night because I'm more of a night owl. Like, I'd start at like 9, and because I just for some reason can't seem to focus. But we both have kids now, and there's none of that. I can't stay up late writing. I think the quality of the work has really suffered on my end since we had kids.
And what about you?
I kind of just always wanted to work on a real people's schedule. Because you can really, like, sort of go into your own little space as a writer and never come out. Like, I'm not, like, setting places at the table for our characters and, like, what would you do? But I don't know. I think, like, it comes from, like, a chaotic childhood of, like, then craving normalcy. Like, I want everything to be normal. So I want to, like, get to work. I mean, by the way, like, in normal meant, like, we rarely start work before 10.
Sure.
It's not like, you know, got things to do.
I get in an office at 8:30. I rarely start work before 10 as well.
Right. So. It's a waste of time anyway. Like, there's no water cooler chat because we can't get it out of the way. And then we try to wrap up so we can have dinner with our families and, you know, start it all over.
When you guys are, you know, coming up with the, you know, ideas and stuff, what are you looking for? Are you coming up with characters first and then building from there? Is there, you know, hey, we want to do something about this theme, and then you think about it. How does that work for you guys? Or is it different from
project? It's always different.
Right. I mean, Liza came with, here's this young woman, and we met with her and we watched some of her comedy, and, like, we built something around what we thought her strengths were and what her appeal was. Or we have a story that's personal to us and we want to tell it, and that will start there, or we'll come across an article or an idea. And it's so funny, like, you see a lot of, like, we spend a lot of articles back and forth to each other, like, oh, in the 90s, someone would have made this into a movie right away.
Like, we did that movie Leap Year we wrote with Amy Adams. That came from an article. Deb saw an article that was like, there was a leap year tradition that women proposed to men in Ireland. And it was like, oh, that could be a movie.
Yeah.
That's the kind of thing. We'd see that now. We were like, oh, that would have been a movie. Because they just don't really do them.
It could have been a movie on Netflix. Now it could be a movie on Netflix.
Netflix is bringing back those romantic comedies.
Yeah, we're here for it.
Higher concepts. So as we're wrapping up, just what are one or a couple lessons that, you know, you've learned along your careers that you wish you had known when you were starting out?
Somehow I feel like I knew more then than I know now. I don't know. the idea that you, because you go into this with thinking you know a lot, you thinking you know how things are going to work, and then you are constantly surprised by how things work and how things change. I mean, that's the thing you couldn't predict when we sold that spec in the 90s was how radically the business is going to change. I think that's, maybe that's it. Maybe it's just got to be adaptable.
Yeah.
You always got to be ready to, you know, kind of, you can't be so rigid, and you really have to, I never would imagine that we'd be making a TV series for YouTube.
Sure.
Because there was a YouTube. Yeah. YouTube didn't exist.
Right. And for you, is there anything that you can think of?
I never have good advice. I don't know. I mean, I think like listen to feedback, but someone just put up a Nora Ephron quote yesterday and said like, don't take any notes from people who don't like your script. And you can tell, like you can tell when people genuinely are into it and want to make it better and are being constructive. And then when there are people who are like, well, they're never going to get this. And I don't really know how much heat I want to pay to.
Yeah. Well, I think that is a good note because young writers, especially, I mean, every writer faces a lot of adversity, and, you know, you have to hear, you know, about, look for the note behind the note, things like that. But if someone's not connecting with the material full stop, then their note probably isn't going to be very useful.
And I do think there is a, like, and Harry said this earlier, like, don't chase the market, because you're always going to be like a step behind, you know? They're not going to be into this kind of movie next year or whatever, when you start writing it now. You should really just write something that, you know, a story that you connect to and feel like needs to be told, as opposed to like what you think the marketplace wants. Because it's so, like, you know, giant things come out and fail. It seemed like they'd be like pure winners, and then some little tiny movie comes along and blows doors off, so.
And the other thing, just connecting to that, is no, we've got lots of advice. is just keep, you have to keep churning out material. You know, a lot of times you'll see people who are very precious because they've written a script and that's it. What? Oh, stop, stop. Not fair. You might start another one. It really is, you can't just think that, okay, this is the one thing I'm going to do. I mean, you may have stuff that you want to hold on to and protect, and that's fine, but you've got to keep writing beyond that. And it's just the more you generate material, the more likely you are to kind of, you know, get something going.
Well, I think that's a great place to leave it. Deborah and Harry, thank you guys so much for your time. Enjoy the rest of the
festival.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thanks again to Deborah Kaplan and Harry Elfont. For my money, Can't Hardly Wait is one of, if not, the best high school party movies of all time. So that was fun. Next up, we have an interview with Ben Cory Jones, who, alongside Lena Waithe, is the co-creator of the new show Boomerang, based on the classic Eddie Murphy film. We discussed that, Ben's work on shows including Issa Rae's Insecure, how he got his start, and more. Check it out.
Ben Cory Jones, thank you for taking the time to be here.
Yeah, thanks for having me, man.
So let's talk about Boomerang first.
Yeah, sure.
It's not a reboot exactly, right? It's a sequel.
Yeah, well, we're calling it, it's definitely not a remake. It's sort of just a reimagining of the series. I think what Lena Waithe and I wanted to do with the show is to introduce the movie to sort of a new generation. She and I both grew up watching the movie. It's a treasured, you know, 90s romantic comedy, a black rom-com. And when we initially met, we met with Halle Berry to sort of talk about the film, because she's one of the executive producers of the series. And her advice to us was like, we had our Boomerang experience, you guys should have your own. And I think when we were reimagining the show, we imagined a world where, when, you know, at the end of the movie Boomerang, Eddie Murphy and Halle Berry, their characters, they walk off into the sunset. And we imagine a world that if they had a kid when the movie aired in 1992, that kid would be 26 years old today. And so our series follows their daughter and her group of friends, as they're also sort of in the advertising industry. But they have these iconic parents. But their question to the series is like, well, how do you get out from under your parents' shadows to find your own life? The series is set in Atlanta and it's filmed in Atlanta. I went to college in Atlanta. So I really want to tell the story of like young black people in a place like Atlanta trying to make it, you know?
That's great. And so you co-created this with Lena Waithe. Talk about that partnership and that collaboration.
Yeah, I mean, she's one of my closest friends for a very long time. And we started out as assistants together in L.A., very much have the same sensibilities, the same sort of comedic feel. But it's important for both of us, even in our own individual careers, to tell Black stories, to tell stories about people of color, to tell stories about queer people. And BET came to us with this opportunity, and we wanted to just do justice and do it right. And again, like to tell a story that is focused on, you know, young people who haven't quite made it yet. I think in the movie Boomerang, Eddie Murphy's made it. Like he has, and it's funny, he's Eddie Murphy. And it's even interesting when we talked about his Marcus Graham apartment, like that iconic apartment that he had in Manhattan. Our lead character, the lead male character, he's not quite there yet. Like, and we asked ourselves, like, there has to be a, like, one doesn't just become Marcus Graham overnight.
Yeah.
What is that process to become Marcus Graham, you know?
The timing is kind of interesting just because Eddie's coming back now as well. Yeah. Dolomite Is My Name is fantastic.
I haven't seen it yet.
Oh, it's great. And yeah, it just feels like people are ready to kind of look at those stories again.
Yeah.
So it must be cool to be involved with that.
Yes, absolutely cool.
Talk about now, you know, this is the first show you've co-created. But you've worked on several shows. What has been the, what's the differences for you? What are the things that, you know, you were prepared for, you weren't prepared for?
Yeah. I mean, it's a lot. I mean, I spent 3 years on Insecure, which is a job that like changed my life. And I love everybody over there. And Issa Rae is a good friend of mine. I learned a lot from our showrunner, Prentice Penny. And I think it goes like, and I've worked on a lot of great people. I worked with John Ridley on American Crime as an assistant. I worked with Ben Watkins on the show Hand of God. I worked with Misha Green on Underground.
I went to college with Misha Green.
Oh, nice. Awesome. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
And so I've worked with a lot of amazing writers, and I've watched a lot of amazing creators create shows. And at a certain point, you know, you want to cobble up all those skills that you've learned. And I've worked in comedy and I worked in drama. And so I really felt like it was my time to take up the mantle and create shows. But for me, what's important is the experience of the writers. I started out in this business as a writer's assistant, as a script coordinator, as a writer's PA. I did all those
did
jobs.
I did all the grunt work.
And I think there was so much a part of me that like just wanted to get at the table. And I think the writer's room to me is a sacred space. And I want to help train up the next young generation of writers the way I was trained. You know, I remember when I was a script coordinator and writer's assistant on American Crime first season with John Ridley. And I never forget, I watched him, you know, the writers and myself included, I would help out whenever or pitch whenever I could. But we arced out the whole first season and I watched him sort of pitch that to the network.
Came
to our writer's room and watching him was like watching a magician or watching like a great American circus leader, if you will. And I just want to carry on the torch and like help making sure that, you know, we can constantly have stories in the pipeline that are diverse and that are interesting, you know?
So when you're staffing up a room, what, you know, you've been in every single position. It's like, So now that you're actually in charge of staffing the room, what are you looking for in writers?
I mean, I'm looking for what you have on the page. If it's like funky and quirky and interesting and specific, you know, a lot of people's pilots that I read, like, again, I want to read somebody's pilot. I just want to read something that tells me about how you think and how you process the world. It doesn't necessarily have to be like a perfectly plotted script, but it has to be a voice. It has to be something that I'm like I have to remember the script. Like, and I think people have to, when you're submitting, like, remember, like, I'm a showrunner. And as I was reading for Boomerang, I remember there was a chunk of time where I was probably reading about 20 scripts a night. Like I would work during the day because we were developing the show and I was meeting during the day and I would go home and read about 15 to 20 scripts a night. And think when people are writing, think about if your script is number 11 in a pile of 20, is your script going to be remembered? And if your answer to that is no, then it, you know, but I think if you are writing something that from page one, it's a clear point of view. From page one, there's like a clear drive, there's a clear character, there's a unique way you tell the story. I think that's what I was looking for because it was exhausting. It was frankly exhausting. And you read a lot of, like, I'm reading a lot of material from, like, I have a bunch of agent friends, so like I'm reading all their clients as a favor almost. Some were good, some were bad, but I think I knew immediately when I ran across a writer who didn't give a shit. Who was like, I'm gonna write my story and I don't care, you know?
And then also there's the element of being in a writer's room where you're spending a lot of time with people. You need to kind of, being in the room is very important. So as far as personalities go and that kind of stuff, what are you looking for in a writer in that way?
Yeah, I mean, for younger writers, I'm looking for people that can just pitch. And when I say pitch, like, if we know that we want these two characters to have sex by the end of the episode, just pitch things that happen until they get there, or pitch a unique way they have sex. I remember on Insecure, I really wanted first season. I personally really wanted to see a black couple have shower sex.
Okay.
And so I kept pitching it, and it got into the show first season. Ethan Lawrence, they have sex in the shower. And what was so fun about that was like, when I pitched that they have sex in the shower, then everyone in the room, we went around the table and all gave our horrible shower sex stories, because shower sex is never as it's never as fun as it sounds. Like, you get soap in your eye, you get shampoo, you almost fall.
Yeah, you slip and fall.
And so then, and that's when we knew that that's what the scene was going to be. When we actually wrote it, we knew that it was going to be this, like, hey, let's have sexy sex in the shower, and then you finally do it, and like Issa almost gets a black eye, you know. And I think like that, like, I want people to like pitch stuff like that. Like, if I say like, oh, we want these characters to have sex, like pitch something that we didn't think about. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I'm a writer that, I mean, I spend a lot of time just thinking about characters. I have a lot of ideas that I like to share, but I just love people that just bring things that I can't think about. Mm-hmm. Like, I think if you've ever been around me in a writer's room, you know, you kind of would know how my brain thinks. Mm-hmm. So like, it's also interesting on Boomerang. We hired this two writing team, Henry Chan and Jing Shin. They are two Asian male writers, and they used to work in advertising. And the show is about advertising to a certain extent. And they would just bring information that I didn't know because I never worked in advertising. And so I think I'm always looking for people. Like, I like people who just have careers. Like, you were an engineer before, or you were a scientist before. That's just fun to me.
Yeah, bring something new to the table.
Yeah.
Now, as a showrunner, you're also dealing with production in a way that you probably, as a, you know, a writer on earlier shows weren't. You're in charge of, you know, big production decisions. What's that adjustment been like for you?
It's huge. big adjustment. I mean, like, it actually has helped me as a writer, because, and I think when you start out writing, you don't want to write to budget and production constraints. You want to just write because you want to teach yourself how to write. You want to like write things that are compelling. But now that I am a showrunner and an executive producer, I already know what our line producer is going to say. And so we shouldn't do two explosions here because it ain't going to happen. and I think it actually challenges us as writers, because now I'm like, okay, if we can put two different scenes in the same location, that saves us a day.
Yeah.
So that we can actually get a day on the back end to do a dance sequence or whatever. And I think that is the thing. I think that's like a person who has a production background or just experience can help in a writer's room to sort of say, like, you know, if we can put these two, combine these two scenes in the same location, redress it, then that'll save us a day. And now we have three scenes in the same location. The actors will be happy, production will be happy. And then because they're happy, they'll let us do this crazy thing at the end. And I think that's the fun of it, you know? It's like problem solving.
Yeah. Let's go way back now. You mentioned you did writer's assistant, script coordinator.
Yeah.
How did you get your start? What was your...
Well, before I moved to LA, I was in New York City. I worked in New York. I was an investment banker.
Ah, so this is why you like people who have careers prior to
undergrad. Yeah, exactly. Because it was challenging and fun, but I was right out of undergrad and I got the job on Wall Street. And then I worked there until the market crashed in 2008. And when the market crashed, I was like, well, fuck it. I might as well move to LA. Because I've always had this like desire to be a writer, and I moved to LA to do it. The first job I got in LA was I got into ABC had a program called the Production Associates Program,
okay,
which is basically like a floated PA program. And so I went from making about $200K a year as an investment banker to making $20K a year.
Hopefully you saved some of that.
I mean, no. I mean, a little, but I mean, it wasn't anything to like, I mean, I had some savings, yeah, but like,
You were living the real life.
Living the real
life.
Life, yeah, for sure. And I got the production program, and then a lot of it, because that program was great, and they don't have it anymore, unfortunately, but it we were basically floater assistants around ABC Studios. And while I was there, it was great. They assigned me a mentor who was a comedy development executive. I would kind of tell people I wanted to be a writer, but I would sort of let it slip out, mm-hmm, very subtly until I just couldn't hide anymore. And then from while I was in, and that's the point that I think I make, is like any job in the entertainment industry is a good job. Like even at a management company or production company, any job is a good job, because what you want is just to start telling people what you want to do. And when you start telling people, they're like, oh, my next door neighbor is a TV creator and he's looking for an assistant. Mm-hmm. I'll tell him when we're out walking our dogs. Mm-hmm. And that's how people get jobs. And so I ran my mouth at ABC, and then I got a writer assistant gig on a show called The Deep End, which was a short-lived show on ABC. It was basically Grey's Anatomy in a law firm.
Okay.
It only lasted like 6 episodes. It was my first job in a writer's room. And then from there, one of the EPs on that show, when that show got canceled, one of the EPs went to another show and I followed her. And so it's like just take one step at a time. But at the same time, I think it's important to mention, I got into the Disney Writing Fellowship in 2013, but it took me 4 years in a row to apply to get in. I got in on year 4.
Stuck with it.
Stuck with it. I was a semifinalist for 2 years. I was a finalist in year 3, and they told me, I think they chose 8 people. I was number 9.
So you had to do it again the next year.
Or did I? Or did I just pack my shit up and go home? But no, I applied again and I got it next year.
And so while you're, you know, you talk about how connections you make in this industry are really, you know, you're moving from one show to another. Yeah. Has that always been something, you know, you find yourself doing as like, are you personable? You find like you networking is important, that kind of stuff?
Yeah, I mean, it really, really is. I mean, generally speaking, people really want to help other people in this business because we all know how difficult it is. And that's why, like, if any job in a writer's room is a good job, because if you can find one writer that can take an interest in you, you've won. Like, and all it takes is one person to say, hey, I'll read your script, or hey, I'll introduce you to my manager, or hey, I'll send your script to a showrunner friend of mine who's staffing. You know, I've known most people I know get jobs that way. I had a friend, his name is, I'm gonna call him out, his name is Theo. And Theo was a writer on, Theo and I did the Bill Cosby writing program together years ago. And Theo was a writer on the show House of Lies on Showtime. Yep. Theo met the showrunner at a bar. They were sitting at the bar. And Theo was like, I forget the showrunner's name, I'm blanking on
it. Was it the Carnahan, right?
No. Yes, exactly. Theo Travers is his name. And Theo said he was at a bar. I used to know the name of the restaurant. I forgot it. I think it's on Fairfax. But again, he was just at the bar, sitting down. And I think at that point, Theo had been staffed on a show before. And he just got to chat, and Matthew Carnahan was sitting right next to him. And the thing about LA is that happens all the time. You know, when you're out somewhere, you never know who you can meet because everybody's in the business. And so the point of advice that I always give is like, just open your mouth and tell people like, and I find that a lot of people they get very like, oh, I don't want to tell people I'm a writer, or I don't want to tell people I have a script. Maybe I just have a loud mouth. I'm from the South. And so I'm from Memphis. And so, you gotta just open your mouth and tell people. And when you open your mouth and tell people, when you get over the fear, you can find that there are so many people to help you.
So what's your process as a writer like? Wake up in the morning and pound pages out? Do you outline heavily? What's your process?
I get up and work out first, and I run or do yoga, or I go to the gym and do weights. And that's when I'm like blue skying stuff. But I work at home a lot. I have a whiteboard at home. I'm a big, like, I like to write, like, just kind of documents. Like, I just want to write down what I'm feeling and why this piece of material or product I'm writing is important to me. Like a summary sheet, almost, which, like, when I'm developing, a lot of networks require that you write that, but I kind of do it on my own now because it helps me to gather my thoughts. And I'll outline pretty heavily, beat sheeting or outlining, one of the two. But I, honestly, when I'm doing a personal pilot that's not like a piece of development or something I'm being paid to write, I kind of want to just get in the script and see what happens. Because it's like, and I know I don't always advise that, but I think at this point I have a very strong sense of story, and so I mean I know I've already arced out this show in my head, and I kind of want to like just regurgitate on the page a bit and then go back and edit.
And when you finish a draft of something, do you have people you share it with? And what's your?
I have one of my I have an assistant. She'll read it, and like she'll pitch me things that she'll tell me what sucks. The thing about me is that I'm very open to people telling me what sucks. I don't profess to know that everything's right. And I think a good writer knows, like, you should be able to ask for people to tell you when it sucks. And my assistant will tell me that it sucks. And
that's a brave assistant.
Brave assistant. But I mean, I have to hire an assistant that's that brave.
Yeah.
Because I can be like, no, this doesn't suck. And they'll be like, no, yeah, it does. I'm like, okay, fine. You know?
And so have you worked... you've worked mostly in television. Any ambitions to move to features, or you like TV?
Yes, I'm actually writing a movie now for HBO. We haven't released what it is yet, but it's a civil rights movie that's set in the business world.
Okay.
I'm very excited about.
Very cool.
Yeah, so I mean, movie thing, and I produced the movie Stepsisters. It's on Netflix. I didn't write it, but Lena and I both produced it. It's fun. It's so different.
Yeah.
It's very different. it's very singular. Like, we have one writer. The story notes was like just Lena, the writer, the director. Whereas I'm used to kind of a whole writer's room and the studio and a network. It really was just like, that was a 6-hour notes meeting.
Wow.
And it was just one meeting. And we went through everything from start to finish with the script. And I guess I like it because I think you want to keep your mind and your writing sharp. And I think TV, you can kind of get in a TV tunnel and you always think about story in terms of TV. But I think the TV people who go to features, we do a better job because I think we're so interested in like pacing and like making sure there's enough stuff to turn a story. Stories move fast in TV. And I think feature for TV people it moves fast.
Well, as we wrap up, one last question. So you've been working a while now. Is there something you've learned along the way, a lesson that you wish you could go back and tell that guy who just moved to LA?
Yeah. I would say, I mean, this is one of the things that I inadvertently decided. Like, I decided that I'm going to be a writer. Now, that sounds simple, but I think there's a push right now for, like, it to be, like, you to be a writer and a performer and a director and a this. And I think me not knowing that one could do all that, I was like, I'm just going to be a writer. I'm going to learn how to write. I'm going to learn how to write well. And once I learned how to write well, I saw that, like, opportunities to me to act came up, to direct, to produce. And I would just say, like, focus on writing. Like, even if you want to be an actor, if you learn how to write, then you know how to read a script. Then you know how to pick a good script. You know how you can tell a bad script from a good script. But I think people are a lot more, like, in a good way, exposed to all the things you can do in entertainment. But it's that problem of riches. Is that you become...
You're okay at a bunch of things. It's a really good one thing.
Yes. And in my opinion, if you become... Acting is kind of its own separate thing because that's like theater and like all that. But like, you can become really good at writing. You have a career for... And I didn't know this. Maybe that's the advice. When you become really good at writing, you have a career for the rest of your life.
Ben, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for having me, man.
Thanks again to Deborah Kaplan, Harry Elfont, and Ben Cory Jones for coming on the show. And of course, thanks to our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review, and if you haven't already, subscribe on Apple Podcasts. For news about future episodes and more, like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This episode was produced by Kayla Guess with help from Sadie Dean and Alice Iroldi. This episode is also made possible with help from our friends at Get Lit, Words Ignite, and Literary Riot Media. Get Lit fuses classic and spoken word poetry to increase teen literacy on the page and in visual media by providing a creative outlet, community, and real-life work experience, transforming students into activists, scholars, and stars. Learn more at getlit.org. Music is by Santiago Arias. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.